I think he had so much to offer. And I think he's been very much misunderstood by a lot of people. And there'll be a lot of people who wrote things about him who will maybe think twice and really ask themselves if they were fair to the man, because he should have been thought of in much better light in the game of football. You get, in Leeds, they should build a shrine to him. They really should.
Leeds United may not have been the most popular outfit in the country over the last 20 years, but they certainly could play, couldn't they? This week, Mick and Alan are going to look back on one of the most formidable club sides that British soccer has ever seen. They really weren't very popular in the early 1970s, but that never bothered Leeds United or their manager, Don Revie. Alan, it's strange, isn't it, that Leeds, despite their success in the 70s, were never really accepted by British crowds?
No, they weren't. First of all, may I say they were possibly one of the greatest club sides that I had the privilege of playing against. Over this period of time, they were very, very good.
We changed all the strip and travel first class and got the best kit for the lads and the best balls and the best boots and made them feel big.
I think outside of Bill Shankly, I would say he's very close second to Bill Shankly. And in my life, you know, that is the highest accolade I can give anyone. They were two fantastic managers.
They were a machine and they were rolling on and they were looking a really good side. And they'd take some stopping.
And as usual, the team to beat were Leeds United, the creation of Bill's great rival, Don Revie.
Well, I think the matches with Leeds United really were the highlights. They were always difficult, intense, and always and amazingly clean.
And if I was picking a World Cup side, and if I was picking the best ever side, I'd pick Jackie Charlton after 26-27. He learned his trade more than I've ever known anybody. 21, you could stick it through his legs and stick it in the back of the net, and he would be looking round to see whose fault it was. But when he got to 26-27, he knew his trade, he knew his job, and I must say that only one man could have taught him his trade, Don Revie. Nobody else could have taught him his trade. And suddenly he became among centre-forwards, he was a guy that you didn't mind playing against. I never minded playing against him. His record, goal-scoring, was good. But under Revie, he became a centre-half. And possibly the best in Europe. And if I was going to pick a centre-half to get me through a championship, I'd stick him alongside Roy McFarlane.
Right in. And it hit him on the bloody heel and went across the ball ground. I did. When I hit it, I thought it was wrong.
They were the first side which you would say were real professionals. You know, I think that a lot of the games we saw before, there was a lot of passion and a lot of feeling. But they as a unit, they did everything right. They had their free kicks organised. They had all their set plays organised. They even say that they, you know, once they got into Europe, they used to get booked in rotation so they wouldn't get banned, you know, because they were a hard side and they could compete. They put their foot in. And, you know, I mean, I always thought that they stuck together. But they were probably the first real professional side and the first people that worked at being what I would say professional or gamesmanship. I don't know what you call it. But, I mean, if there was anything that... any shortcut of getting an advantage, they were up to it. They had pros at it, Bremners and your Gileses. They knew every little dodge and every, you know, Hunter would kick you up the backside, you know, bite your legs, as they used to say. But they were really pros.
Yes, in fact, I was talking with Jet Charlton a little bit earlier, and we reminisced about the early days of the 70s when I played against Jet's great Leeds team. And, you know, of all the teams I've played against in my career, including the great Liverpool teams, that was undoubtedly the best team I've ever played against.
Really?
Yes.
They worked hard for each other. They had such an awful lot of ability. But within the confines of that, they had people who knew exactly what they were doing. And as I say, they knew every trick in the book. And you've got to put an awful lot down to the manager for that.
See, I often think that there's no big secret to great teams. You know, when you start looking at your Coopers, your Hunters, your Bremners, your Gileses, your Clarks, Jonesy, Eddie Gray. I mean, you've got five or six, seven great players. All of a sudden, come together in one team. You know, obviously you've got to have a manager. And, you know, Revie was the one, to be fair, who brought the kids and that through. So he's got to take, you know, an awful lot of credit.
Down.
He's a very knowledgeable player in terms of football. He's willing to talk football 24 hours a day.
And again, on similar lines to Nobby Stiles, he's willing to muck in.
Because they had some hard minutes, like Reaney, Bremner, Giles. I mean, let's be fair, Giles and a little a Norman Hunter, you know, and people like that. So they had some hard men, but over 90 minutes with Leeds, I've got to give them fair credit to them. We hated each other, and we hated them, and they hated us. And we knew we were in for a battle. We knew they're going to come over the top. They're going to do you. They're going to kick you off the ball. And you know, when the referee's not looking, you know, they moan, they whinge, and they do everything to. They try to win. They did everything. They got to the referee. I've got to admit, they were a great side. I mean, I think I played all over the world. I was very lucky to play all over the world. And I've got to say that Leeds side was probably the best club side I ever played against, to be honest.
And no doubt a lot of our younger viewers wonder what on earth we're talking about when we talk about the great Leeds teams of years gone by. But in the 60s and 70s, they won two league titles. They were runners-up in the first division five times. They reached four FA Cup finals and five European finals. Though they spent 8 years in the second division, Leeds United are unquestionably one of the premier clubs in the country. And it's good to see them back in the first division. The Leeds fans.
Picking up, Alan, on your comments about Leeds United, the great Leeds United team. I had the pleasure of playing against them, oh, I think it was something like 1971 or 72 when I was with Birmingham City. We played in the semi-final at Hillsborough. And I think that of all the teams I've played against in my career at club level, that Leeds team were the best I've ever played against.
Well, that's some statement.
Billy never took any prisoners. I mean, Johnny Giles, oh, dear me, don't turn your back. You know, Big Jack and Norman. Anything that moved Norman was, you know, like he says, Don Revie used to tell him, you win the ball, son, and give it to somebody who can play.
Oh, aye. Clarkie was there, about five or six of them that could really dish it out in the Leeds team. And but they were a great side, and saying that, they were a nasty side, kick their grannies they would. But they were a great side. I thought they were the best team of the 70s in the 10 years.
I can see his chest coming out as you're speaking.
He's ready. I'll just give him one of the
right. Interesting, just near the end there, everyone in the Chelsea defence expecting the blockbuster from Lorimer, and he just chipped it over the wall and was very unlucky.
If you've ever been in a wall and you know he's coming up to run and hitting one, I'll tell you, you'd be absolutely delighted if he chipped it. Because I'll tell you, he couldn't half hit a ball.
Yeah.
I remember going up there with Southampton when we used to play a system 1-9-1. I was the one. In the end, because that's how good they were.
A bit lonely, was it?
Oh, dreadful it was. Lone Ranger I was.
Right. Giles from Manchester United, didn't they?
That's right.
I remember playing in the early days, and Billy Bremner was a right winger, frightened to death.
Billy Bremner was an Johnny outside. Giles was, wasn't he?
Billy Bremner was an outside right for Leeds as a kid, and he was frightened to death. But he came in within that framework of that team, and one of the best little competitors I had the privilege of playing against, and I used to really enjoy my games against him because you knew it was going to be a right ding-donger. But within that framework of that team, he gathered strength. Johnny Giles was a right wing for Manchester United. He came into that midfield and gathered strength from the whole framework of the team around them.
We've just seen a marvellous goal from Eddie Gray. It has to be one of the great individual goals of the 70s, doesn't it? I mean, he left virtually everyone in that Burnley defence on their backside.
Well, that's right. It was tremendous skill. You know, I mean, he had two or three drag backs, didn't he? I mean, once on the byline, he looked as if he was going to cross it, and he dragged it back and sent the fella. He had to pay to get back in there, that right back, didn't he, there once? but then he's come in and he's beat, I don't know, how many men did he beat? Three or four?
Or more.
And see, I mean, I tell you, at the end, he improvised great because he more or less toe-poked it. Because when the space closed down, I thought he was more or less a toe, he just jabbed it, didn't he?
Yeah.
And he hit it early and that. And it flew in the corner. It was a great goal.
Well, the fact that he used both feet about three times. It was a drag back right to left, left to right. And he was just wrong-footing people all the way along the line. And fantastic sequence of seeing a player use both feet and use his body to beat people in tight areas. It was one of the special goals that I've ever seen.
Gray still up there. Eddie Gray. Oh, good footwork by Gray, still going. Oh, what a lovely goal, what a masterly goal by Eddie Gray.
They were the best team I know at that time. They started keeping the ball, which no other English team used to do. I mean, you know, be patient, you know. I mean, that wasn't heard of really in English football. We had to get it forward, get it in the penalty area and score goals. They started keeping the ball, knocking the ball back, being patient, knocking it wide, bringing it out back out ball-y, weren't they? And it was that was the type of team they were, and they were probably the first at it.
But they never
intimidated referees, they intimidated other teams, they stuck together. Anybody went into a tackle, anything like an injury, woof, they were all there. And they would fight as 11. There'd be people out the box. They were so together.
That's what they were like. I mean, Giles, he was a nasty little bit of work. Yeah, I mean, probably he was on a par with Terry Payne, you know? I mean, he was probably the most hated player in the game. And then you got little Bremner. Ooh, he was a vicious little man. You know, and Norman Hunter was the nicest, off the pitch, wasn't he? When you were away with England, he was the nicest bloke you could wish to meet. And on the pitch, he wouldn't kick your face on, you know? But he'd tread all down the backs of your calves as soon as you had your back to him. You know, I mean, it was...
Yeah. It's easy
They had it sussed. They were the first team to really, you know, get everything weighed up and take every advantage they possibly could.
He was a very warm, friendly man who had a great family himself and encouraged the family atmosphere in a football club, which is very difficult. And he produced some tremendous players who carried on, a lot of them in football, to do good things. And that came out of the family type of club that he had.
I think for 2 or 3 years at Leeds United, he probably produced sides as good as anywhere in the world up to that point. I've got great affection for him, and I'm just so sad that the end was such a painful one for him and came so devastatingly early. I've got great memories of Don Revie, and he'll go down, I think, as one of our great football managers. Let's pick up Leeds United now when they go on to the attack, because they're equally impressive as their record shows.
This is a situation, Bremner taking the throw in, and Cherry picks the ball up and he plays a long ball into Jordan. Now Jordan will control this ball here and he'll just knock it into Yorath. Now 9 out of 10 players would have played this ball forward, but he checks it and he plays it deep onto the halfway line. Now the space there for this player to play, there's Reaney and there's Lorimer. And there's Maley again, you know, making himself available. But the time and space is tremendous. And this is where Chelsea don't really close up quite enough. Now, they knock the ball out again. And here's Lorimer again. And he picks his spot. And there's Jordan getting up very, very well and knocking an excellent ball down for Jones. And Jones volleys a tremendous goal. But the time, you know, the time and their availability, the players' availability is tremendous there.
Why is it they've been able to achieve it and other clubs with good resources also have not been able to achieve it?
I think that Leeds have probably played more continental sides than any other team in a long period of time, in 10 years. And I think they've copied some of their possession ideas. Mm. And also they're so accurate and they're so simple and they're so professional. They're great professionals like Bremner and Hunter. I mean, they're really great professionals. Mm. And they get onto each other. You know, there's more or less 11 coaches out there getting onto each other, yeah. Saying you do this, you do that.
Yeah. when we played, there was a lot of tough fellas around. You know, Tommy Smith and Ronnie Yates, Jerry Byrne and our team. And we believe when he tells stories about Liverpool, oh, yeah, remember that team, Liverpool. But we competed, funnily enough. And I mean, if two players went in for the ball, bang, it was one of them bust the ball thing. It wasn't going in behind people and whacking them and kicking them.
He'd kick it every time he could, you know, but he would go for the ball, obviously, but he wasn't too bothered about which order he got it, ball a man or man a ball, you know. He was good tackle, but on top of that, he was still a wonderful footballer, very skillful, and scored a lot of goals from midfield play.
And they say people with flame hair got a real temper, you know, I've heard that one, but he had a temper, but he had this great vitality, enthusiasm. The instant memory of Billy Bremner will be his great fighting spirit, the big heart, the enthusiasm. That is, it was only his character, that was a person. Then you can then analyse him as a footballer, and then you'll come up with the various things about his great feet, his passing, his perception of passing, and his ability to score important goals.
Score. If you look at the goal that was scored by Billy Bremner in there, that quick free kick, mate, that was typical, if you like, of what Alan was describing. They just took advantage all the time.
Well, that's right. I mean, they were that much more alive. I mean, lots of other things which we didn't see. They were good at throwing. They'd pick throw-ins up and take them quick. Free kicks they would get before people got back and knock early free kicks in. And Clark used to score a lot of goals at the near post with that. But that was a great example, wasn't it? You know, I mean, he's got a foul. He didn't moan or groan. He put the ball down, clipped it in, it was all over, wasn't it? I mean, but at the end of the day...
You know, I walked out on him as an England player, and he phoned me up and told me to come back. He's like a father to me, you know, and he saved my England career. He's a great manager.
As far as football is concerned, he helped me tremendously and a lot of other young managers starting off. He always made you feel as if you were first division, even though you were managing in the fourth at the time. And he was always first on the telephone with any advice, especially if you weren't doing too well.
Division Championship is something which you both been contesting really for the last 10 years, isn't it?
Oh yes, I think so, that it's been a kind of monopoly, you know. Possibly we invented the word monopoly, Leeds and Liverpool.
They were very naughty, George, weren't they? I mean, to play against them as a forward player.
Oh, I used to dread playing against them. I mean, apart from the fact that, as you say, they could play a bit.
Now, to be fair on Leeds, they played quite well there, didn't they?
Oh, they could play. I mean, that's what we were saying. That it's a shame they just didn't. You know, you saw towards the end there, you know, a couple of the Leeds players have gone. Norman's gone in there and kicked Alan Ball a couple of times. And you've seen the reaction, what's happened just after it, when the Arsenal boys just got stuck in. And that tended to happen during the games, you know, it was...
But they were a great team, though, weren't they? I mean, you can't take away from Leeds, they were a great team in those days. You play at Leeds, but the team that played was a brilliant team, and they could win games. You'd go there, and you knew if you got one goal behind, you were in trouble.
So the record, then, is safely with Leeds United. It's going to take an awful lot of beating. Television commentators, journalists, fans indeed, have been raving about Leeds since yesterday afternoon. What is it when a pro looks at Leeds United that impresses him most?
Well, I think that the ability of their forwards to recognise how to defend and do really defensive things in defensive situations, and the ability of their defenders that when attacking, they attack and think like forwards. Mm. Also, their tremendous composure and their ability to create space there's all these terms that are talked about football, but this team, you know, they really create things, and they really create tons of space and plenty of time to play, you know, by their accuracy and by their simplicity of their play.
They use the whole width of the pitch as well.
Yeah, they use the width, you know, they can play in tight situations, and they draw players into tight situations, then they play out of them, and there's plenty of places to play. Mm. You know, they get them in there, and they get three or four of them in there, and they play it back there and play it across the other side of the park. And they use the width of the pitch wonderfully. I mean, you'll see Cherry coming on this side, and you'll see Rini coming on this side. Mm. When they've got time. And there's always two alternatives. Yeah. They can always play inside or out.
You mentioned their composure, and their composure in defence yesterday was quite magnificent. And we've got an excellent illustration of this.
You see, in this clip of film here, you see Garland play a ball through. It's a Chelsea attack, but the composure with which Maley comes around, takes the ball out, and they play this ball out of defence so with so much composure. Nice little chip there into Bremner. Bremner's got his back to the game, so he brings the ball back. And you'll see Maidley again showing himself, you know, wanting to take this ball off Bremner. He takes it off Bremner again, plays it inside. There's three players there. There's Hunter, plays another little ball to him. And Maidley brings it back again. And you see two players pointing. You see Hunter and Cherry telling him where to play. And he plays a little ball into Yorath. And now you've got four Chelsea players in that corner of the park. Now that creates a tremendous amount of space on the other side of the park. Mm. And this is where Cherry will go there. And if they want to play to Cherry, he's got 30, 40 yards to play in. And so this is the great thing about their play, their ability to play it tight, nice control, nice neat little passes, and all of a sudden change the play, and the Chelsea players, you know, four or five of them out of the game.
How would you rate Leeds United, Malcolm? Are they the greatest club side, you think, of all time in Britain, as I've seen quoted?
I would think so, yes. I think that they play the best football I've seen from any English side ever. And probably comparable to some of the great teams that I've seen in, you know, like Hungary.
Better say than Spurs of the 1960s?
Yeah, I think they're a better side, yeah. Much more capable side.
Yeah. Let's just finally go back to Leeds. Whatever you think about them, Leeds United have certainly had us talking, haven't they?
Oh, yeah, I don't think you can get away from it. They really got it together, didn't they?
You can't ignore them, can you?
They were the best club side at the time, and I played for a really good side, Everton, at that time. They were the best club side that I think I've ever played against in Europe or in this country. And all credit to them, the players, Don Revy, Lescock, and everybody involved in them. Sid Owen was there at the time. Good luck to them, because in my memories, they were the best club side I played against.